Thank you for coming out to see us tonight. When I met my wife, Judy, I was playing music that was kind of like this. And Judy was playing music that was more like this. And I thought, well, we'll date, but we'll never play music together.
That's true.
But as fate would have it, a Borders opened up near us, and they wanted to know if we would play there. And at that time, we were getting into swing music of the 30s and 40s together. And we'd like to play for you one of the first songs we ever played together. This is a song by the great stride pianist Fats Waller, and it's called Honeysuckle Rose.
Thank you very much. So we just started playing very casually at this Borders, books and music in the cafe area, and just fun, you know. And then people started wanting to hire us, which was fun too. And they would ask for specific requests. For example, in March for St. Patrick's Day, we would start to get some requests to do Irish and Celtic music. And Mark has just brought out his second instrument, his mandolin, and we are going to go to Ireland for our next trip here around the world.
I'd like to play you a song by the one of the most famous composers from Ireland. His name was Turlough O'Carolan, and he lived in the mid-1600s, early 1700s. And Turlough, at the age of 18, became blind and took up the Irish harp as a way of making money. And he became so prolific as a composer and so renowned as a player that it became a trend amongst the wealthy back then in Ireland to hire him to compose songs for them. And the first song we're going to play for you is a beautiful ballad that he wrote called Shebaic Shamor. And then we're going to go into a traditional Irish hornpipe called The Boys of Blue Hill. Okay. Thank you very much. So, one thing that we spend a lot of time working on is the arrangements that we did. For instance, in that first Irish song, the ballad, we came up with our own variation. We actually composed that second section that we played after we stated the melody. And this next song we're going to play is another example of an arrangement that we put a lot of time into prior to playing. It's a Venezuelan waltz. And some of the elements of the Venezuelan waltz are the rhythm of the waltz. And the bass runs that are idiomatic to the genre. And Judy's gonna put in some harmonics, those little bell-like sounds that the guitar makes. And this is called...
Como llora una estrella, which means as the star weeps. And it's a very beautiful, well-known song throughout Latin America.
And it's an example of how we take a somewhat simple melody and embellish it. And each time we go through, we vary and change things a little bit.
The mandolin requires a lot of tuning all the time because it's in pairs and each pair is a unison. So if it's just a little bit out of tune,
we get a sound like this, which makes for a really long song.
That's not preferable.
And I can feel myself getting a look from my wife.
No.
And I just put new strings on and these are difficult tonight, but I will persevere. Okay. Thank you. So we'd like to go to Italy now. The mandolin is originally from Italy. And Antonio Vivaldi was writing concertos with violins for the mandolin back in the 1600s. And then in the late 1600s, early 1700s, the mandolin that we came to know now originally was the soprano lute that Vivaldi was writing for. And in the late 1600s, early 1700s, the modern mandolin came to be. And originally the Italian ones had like a big round back to them. Maybe you've seen some of the old bowl back mandolins. And there was much disagreement over whether the tuning should be like a violin or like a small guitar. And the violin tuning won out. That's the sound that you hear. And then there was much disagreement over whether the strings should be made out of gut, which I think must have been really inconvenient back then, or metal strings. And metal strings originally is what came to be. And that's part of the main reason why I took up the mandolin is because I love how the bright metal sound of the strings sound with the nylon strings of Judy's classical guitar. So we're gonna go to Italy and play for you a tarantella. A tarantella is a dance, a happy dance from the southern part of Italy. The meter to it, or the count is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the story behind the tarantella is that if you're bitten by a tarantula and you dance this dance, you'll be okay. But I don't know, I wouldn't take my word for it.
We're going to be playing a piece called La Danza by Rossini, and this wasn't written for one of his operas, but it's from a group of pieces that he wrote for voice and piano. I basically took the piano part and worked out my arrangement for guitar as closely as I could to what was being done on the piano. And Mark is doing the vocal part. And some words in the chorus are, "Now the moon is over the ocean and the hour is beautiful for dancing." It may be somewhat familiar to you, this melody. A lot of other composers used it as the basis of their pieces. Chopin and Liszt and some other pianists incorporated this melody into their music.
Thank you.
ago, got invited to play at the Caramore Center for the Arts. It's in Katona, New York. And they have a beautiful grounds there, and they have a lot of different kinds of concerts. And
Yo-Yo Ma had played there the week before.
Yeah.
Although he played in a bigger hall. Yeah.
But there was a very wealthy couple that bought the property and built this Mediterranean-style house there. I don't know if any of you have ever been there. But in their house, they built an auditorium that they called the music room, but it's like a 150-seat auditorium. That gives you an idea of what the house is like. There's a Spanish courtyard. It's just beautiful. And it was so exciting to play in this setting. But we were asked to play for a special Mediterranean celebration day, and they wanted us to play all music from the Mediterranean. So we had a lot from the area, but we didn't have anything from Greece, and we decided to put together a few pieces. So we'd like to play for you this set of three pieces that we just recently put together for that event. And the first one is probably familiar. It's Miserlou, which is a traditional Greek song, but has also been played by rock groups and what group was?
Dick Dale.
Surf guitar. And then also a lot of klezmer groups play it. And then we're gonna go right into another one called Kritikos Sirtos. And there's gonna be a little pause. And then our third one is called Hioti, which is the name of a famous bouzouki player from the mid-1900s. So either this was something he wrote or a solo that he wrote, played.
And prior to the bouzouki becoming the most popular instrument in Greece, the mandolin used to hold that title, actually, so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One thing that makes Greek music sound the way it does is the notes of the scale that we change. Instead of our usual D scale, where we would hear like this. We've all heard that before. But we change a couple of notes, we flat the second note of the scale and flat the sixth note of the scale, and we get a sound like this. And the most famous song from that scale is it's written right on that scale.
Where are we now?
Now we're off to Spain, which the guitar is considered the national instrument of Spain. And we're going to play one of the most beautiful and well-known pieces in the classical guitar repertoire. It's called Recuerdos de la Alhambra, which means Memories of the Alhambra. Some of you may be familiar with it. It's a beautiful Moorish palace in Granada. And throughout the palace, there are fountains of water. So wherever you are in the palace, you can hear water flowing. And the composer used a technique called the tremolo, which imitates the sound of water flowing. It's just written for solo guitar, but we added in a part for Mark to give him something to do while I'm playing, so he wouldn't be bored.
Thank you.
Thank you.
off this first half with a song by a great gypsy guitarist, Stokolo Rosenberg. He plays in the style of Django Reinhardt, and he also gets off into a lot of other styles. This is called the gypsy bossa style, and we have this on our second CD, Two Guitars Live. And we'll be taking a short break. As he said, you can go around to the downstairs for some refreshments, and we'd be happy to talk with you if you have any questions.
Thank you.
said thank you. A couple of people said they felt like dancing, so we don't really want to inhibit anyone. So, you know, if you, I think there's a little room here and there.
So I thought I'd tell you a little bit about ourselves. I started playing guitar when I was 10, and the first song that I ever played was Secret Agent Man. Let me try that again. And the cool thing about Secret Agent Man was you could play with one finger. Then my dad was from Maine, and they had some kind of law back then that you could only play country and western music in Maine. So I learned some Johnny Cash to keep Dad happy. And then rock and roll came along.
You did that for about 20 years, I think.
A little more, actually. And I looked at the guitar as if it were a puzzle. I would try to find where my favorite guitarists were playing what they were playing. So if I heard the Beatles or Chuck Berry going, I'd pick up the needle of the record player. A couple of you might remember record players, I don't know. And I would go until I finally found it. And it seemed like the guitar was everywhere back then. For instance, you'd turn on the TV and you'd hear a... Anybody name that tune? Yes. And then there was a group called The Ventures that made some songs like... So that was one of the first instrumentals I learned. And then that same group also did I was like 12 when I learned that, and I thought, wow, that's really cool. That's called Walk, Don't Run. But while I was teaching myself, my wife Judy took more of an academic approach. Oh, but first, there were the Girl Scout campfires. Young Judy Handler first learned Freight Train by Elizabeth Cotton. And then the Beatles came along. And everybody wanted to play the guitar. And then Judy studied classical guitar in Chicago, where she grew up, and Cincinnati, where she went to college, and then got a master's degree in classical guitar performance at the Hart School of Music in West Hartford, Connecticut. And so you have two completely different styles here. How many years did you go to school for this? Many years. And I learned to play hanging out with my friends. So we had two different styles. I'd like to play you a song that was originally a Yiddish melody, and eventually it became a hit here in the U.S. by the Andrews Sisters. And it's called By Mir Bis Tu Shem. Thank you.
different part of the world here to Cape Verde. And I first heard this next one on a CD by the great classical guitarist John Williams. I don't know if any of you are familiar with him. He made a CD called The Magic Box. He went to Africa and just collaborated with all these different musicians in different countries and made this wonderful CD. And I heard this song, Triangular Situations, by a composer from Cape Verde, Vasco Martins, and I just fell in love with the melody. And we couldn't find the sheet music, so I just listened to the CD and got the melody, and we came up with our own arrangement of it. And then after we started performing it, a friend of ours who's a guitarist said that he had arranged one of the other pieces from this CD to play with his daughter who plays violin. And the mandolin is tuned exactly the same as the violin, so his arrangement worked really well for us. And it's called Obia by composer Francis Bebe from Cameroon. And it's a dance. So first we have kind of a beautiful slow waltz kind of ballad, and then we're going to go into Obia. Thank you. Thank you. I don't know what a Makossa dance looks like, but if anyone ever knew, I'd have to look that up on YouTube. That was called the Makossa.
And that song, Obia, translates to be careful. And recently I was watching a movie from Africa, and some kids in the village were chasing an ostrich, and their mother was yelling out, Obia, Obia. And I knew what she was saying. I was like, wow.
But if she had said anything else, you would have been out of luck.
No, I wouldn't know the thing. We'd like to go to Brazil now and play you an example of a Brazilian choro. Brazilian choro originally happened in the late 1900s, and it was kind of a mix of classical music with Brazilian rhythms. And this one's just kind of a fun choro. If you play the mandolin down in Brazil, you have to play this. It's called Brasileirinho. Somebody asked how we ended up playing all this different music from different parts of the world, and it did start from people requesting different things. We were asked to play like 2.5 hours of Italian music for a Tuscany-themed wine dinner in Vermont, and then we were asked to play hours of Celtic music. And then I just realized how much more I was enjoying this than playing the rock and the blues that I started off with. And there were so many different rhythms from all different countries. And each country and culture had its own kind of trademark music, be it the tarantella from Italy, or the tango from Argentina, or the waltz from Paris. And it suddenly got to the point where if we're not playing this, maybe nobody else is anymore, now that rock and roll is completely taken over the world. So anyways, we've played over 2,000 performances together, Judy and I, and we've only turned down two. First one, somebody wanted a couple of hours of German drinking music for an Oktoberfest, and I wasn't sure what to do, but in retrospect, I would have hired a tuba player and an accordion, and I would have played rhythm guitar all night. That would have been easy. The other one was, at the Wadsworth Athenaeum, they had an exhibit of Chinese art, and they wanted Chinese music, and I didn't want to have to turn that down because I've always loved the sound of the Chinese instruments. There's the gunzing, which is kind of a zither, and there's the pipa, which is the lute or small guitar type instrument, and the mandolin instrument is liuqin. And so I wanted to learn a song from China, and we found a lovely a love song from Taiwan called Spring Breeze that we'd like to play for you now. One thing, what makes Asian music or Chinese music sound different from our music is the notes of the scale that you leave up. So instead of our D scale that I was talking about before, we take a couple notes out, which doesn't sound like much by itself, but if you extend the scale, you get. So by having a five-note scale instead of our seven-note scale, you end up with a completely different kind of sound. And we'd like to play a few Spring Breeze. This is an arrangement we came up with. Judy has lowered her sixth string to a D for a more deep sound. Thank you. That one took a long time for us to arrange because we kept coming up with different devices. And how we come up with our own arrangements is one of us will come up with an idea for a song, and then Judy will work out something classical, and I'll say, well, I don't know, that sounds a bit too classical. And then I'll come up with something, and she'll say, well, that sounds a bit too sloppy. And then we go back and forth quite a bit until we compromise. I'd like to play you a couple of songs that have a Jewish origin to them. This first one is called Los Bibelicos, which means the nightingales. And this song was written before 1500 sometime. And it amazes me when melodies have just been around for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years as a result of a mother singing lullabies to their children or whatever. And then we're going to go into a Middle Eastern sounding melody, again using that other scale, called A Song from Merom.
To hear us tonight, we really appreciate it, and thank you, Andrew, and the people at the church for starting this new series, and you should all tell all your friends about it and bring them to the next concert. It's great that they've started music here in the church. It's a beautiful setting, and the acoustics are so nice.
And thank you to you all for supporting live music. Really, yay. Thank you very much.
We know you can hear music any time of the day or night, but it's not the same as being live. We are going to end our little tour of the world in Hungary, and we were asked to play something from Hungary a couple of years ago, and we found this wonderful piece. It's a sardas, which is a dance. It's called Swallows Flying. You look like you have something to say.
I wanted to mention that we have three CDs for sale, and that all three of our CDs were chosen by the Hartford Arts Council in Connecticut as fundraising gifts for people who donated $100 or more to their annual fundraising campaign. And actually, over, 4,000 people paid $100 each for our CDs. And when you think that we're selling them for a special South Deerfield price of $10 each tonight, the savings are enormous, really. You know. And the more you spend, the more you save, of course. I remember.
Okay, thank you for that advertisement. If you have any more questions or anything, we'd be happy to talk with you. And this is Swallows Flying. It's a circle dance where they would speed up and slow down and speed up, and we're going to do that. Thank you so much. Thank you. We'll do one more for you. This is completely different.
We're going to go to England now and play you a song that Paul McCartney wrote. When Paul McCartney and George Harrison of the Beatles, when they were boys, before the Beatles actually started, they were playing around with trying to play a Bach Bore that went something like this. But back then, neither one of them had the chops to do it, so to speak, and Paul McCartney ended up using those intervals of a tenth to write this song from their White album called Blackbird. Thank you so much for spending your evening with us. Thank you.